disappointing in this?
What is that in relation to the surroundings? Say again? Well, how high am I? If I'm standing here, I am 3.7, whatever. It could be feet, could be miles, you know, it's a valley. Yeah, so it's like a little valley, right? Because it's going down, down, down. Now, so if I were to move in this direction, my height is decreasing. I love it. Now, let's take it back to very specifically in the X and Y. FX, FY. So if I'm standing here, you with me? Is FX negative, positive, or zero?
Positive.
So what does FX mean? It means what the height does as I move in the X direction. So if I move, now see how everything ties together. If I move in the X direction only, Y is a constant. Okay, that's what FX means. Y is a constant. X is my only true variable. That's how we take the derivative. So that's how I interpret it physically. So right here, wherever it was, fx has to be negative because I am going down. My height is decreasing. That's all there's to it. That's the visual kind of problem that you'll see related to fx, fy. What's fy here? That's kind of hard. Let's say it like right here. Fy, this one is 4, and that's 3.7, so fy would be positive. Now let me go. This was the hard part right there. This is difficult for some reason because if I do FY, what am I following?
The
level curve. And what's true about every point on this blue curve here? What's true about every point right here? Same height. So if I'm on it and I'm like it's at the vertex in a way. Do you guys see that? That means if I move a little bit in that direction, I'm still on that curve, which means right here, FY would be
zero.
I love it. So I'm going to give you a problem just like this on the test. Right? And there are problems in the homework just like this. I'm going to make it very, very obvious about are you at that point where it should be zero or are you at a point where it isn't. So like right here, it wouldn't be zero. What would FX be here?
Positive.
Yeah, because I'm going from 4 to 4.2. Do you guys see how to see that? It's that simple if you realize that. Remember what FX means. And then I'm going to give you a point. I'm going to have it on there, A. Point A, what's FX? And you're saying, as I move in that direction, am I going up or am I going down? That's it. And that is the slope, right? That's what the slope is all about. Let's see. Well, there's something that's interesting. So like right here, what would FY be? Zero, because I'm following the level curve so that my height wouldn't change. I'm actually on that part of the mountain where it's just going around. I'm just, oh, thank God, this is nice. Lovely hike. Yes?
So you're just taking the tangent in relation to that y or that x at that point, and you're just following the tangent?
No. Make sure everybody understands. This is not the function, right? The function, what do these numbers represent? The actual function is if I lifted this to a height of 4 and I lifted this to a height of 3.7, that would be the surface. So the surface looks something like it goes to 4 and then 3.7. It goes 4 and then 3.7 and then 3.2. There's a bit of a dip there and then it goes back up, right?
Okay.
So there's a little dip here. So right here it looks sort of parabolic maybe. Right through the center of that. Do you guys see that? So it goes down and then back up. But these numbers represent the third dimension. They represent that height above the XY plane. So I'm living in the XY plane as my inputs. So that's what I said earlier about we're going to be looking at these things in two different ways at once. How I move around my inputs and the corresponding change in my outputs. Right? So we want to be really used to this because it's so much easier in 2D. But you have to understand what this really means. The surface is above it. This far above it at these points. So if I were to move, like I said earlier, if I were to move from here and say, what's fx? I'm actually at a 3.2, and as I move in the x direction, what's happening to my heights? They're going up. That's why fx is positive, because the output is increasing in that direction. Cool, I like it.
You just have to say if it's going positive or negative.
Yeah, or zero if you happen to be following. So if you're right there, where it's sort of like what you said about it, but not quite. But because if I move a little bit in that direction, I'm staying on the curve. Therefore, that means I must be, there must be a zero change. Now let me say it a different way. Fx, where's a good point? Fx here is negative, right? If I were to go this way, it's a positive. So it makes sense that, you know, that this is negative. Now watch. If I were here and I were to go this way, if I were to go too far, here's the mistake people make, is they go all the way out to here and they say, okay, right here, Fy is positive. Because they go too far. Fy is the instantaneous change, right? But notice how you can help yourself. If you go the other way, isn't that like also positive? So the only way you could be at a point where both directions go up is if you are... Yes, so that must be zero right there. If it truly is positive or negative, the other direction must be the other, right? If I'm going this way, that's negative. The other way is positive. Okay, cool. That checks out. But if I am somewhere, where's another easy to see spot? I don't want you to keep using the same spot. If I'm here, that way, if I go too far, I think it's going to be positive. And this way is also positive. It's got to be zero in the middle. Does that sort of, that's like a check to make sure that you're looking at this correctly. All right, maybe.
So you're only hitting at that one spot. You're not actually caring about the actual tangent line as it goes on that increase.
So the corresponding tangent line at the surface to this point would be flat, right? Because the slope really is zero. But it's coincidental that it kind of corresponds to, I don't want to say this. Where it flattens out with respect to x or y. So I would say that this flattens out with respect to y. You guys see what I mean by that? Right here, and say it flattens out with respect to y. And you're used to me saying stuff like, well, it's flat. Where does the parabola flatten out? Right there. Because in 180, what were you only in? D by dx was what ruled today. So it flattened out with respect to x. So where's this flatten out with respect to y? There also, right? So it happens that where it flattens out with respect to y, fy will be zero there.
But if you pick a point, say between 3.2 and 3.5, or 3.2 and 3.7, I'm sorry.
Here? Oh, here.
Right there, yep. Right in the middle, right? And if you were to take fy, f sub y, wouldn't that be slightly decreasing?
Yes, slightly decreasing. Now, obviously, I'm going to ask you something that's more obvious. Right, because I could pick a point here where it's like, I don't know, and I'm not going to do that. I could pick a point very carefully and it'd be like right here, and you're like, what's Fy? I don't know. So I'm not going to do that to you. There's not enough detail here to ask you a point anywhere. Does that make sense? So I'm going to use the detail in the picture to pick a point that's very obvious. That here, what's Fx going to be?
Positive,
because I'm on 3.2, and if I go in the x direction a little bit, I'm moving towards a higher place, right? So that's going to be positive change in the output. Okay, I like it. So depending on the level of detail, the resolution in my level curves, there's more or less points I could pick to ask you questions about. So there's a lot of evil points that would be basically impossible to tell because there's not enough resolution. All right, I like it. So that was one thing I wanted to talk about. What was the other thing, Jeff? Oh, yeah, this is kind of nifty. Let me see if I can get this to a point. Now, here's an example of what we were just doing. So, this yellow line, I don't think they tell you anywhere. This yellow line is the gradient. They actually tell you that? Unit vector line. Okay. And this is when I can control the direction I'm looking in. What does the gradient tell you again? If I move in that direction, I'm going to do what? The gradient. What does it tell you?
The vector of the edge.
All right, I love it. So the gradient technically, and this is red, this operator is called the del operator. So you'll see some people call this del f. I call this grad f. I'm just used to calling it grad f. Gradient. So this is for a 2D thing, it would be fx as y at that point. No, no, be careful. All right. So the directional derivative in some direction, that would be the del of f dot u. All right. This has got to be a unit vector. All right, but the gradient by itself, what does it tell you? By itself, what does the gradient for a point tell you?
Changing the x position.
So when I marry it with the idea of a directional derivative, so if I take the dot product between these two, I'm going to end up with the derivative in that direction. So it would be like the slope. So once I'm on a surface, the surface is three-dimensional. If I'm standing at a point looking in a certain direction, do you understand that I'm actually living in a plane then? Is that, so then it's really, the directional derivative is just the slope of the curve of intersection of that plane and the surface. That's really all that is. So if I want to go in a certain direction, I pick a direction to go in, and that's that blue vector. That's the direction I want to go in. The yellow one is the gradient, right? When is this derivative? And this is really just like a normal derivative, to be honest. The answer could be 7, which means if I take a step in that direction, I expect to go 7, my height to increase by 7. Does that make sense? That's what it means. That's what the derivative means. When, how do I make this the largest? Because it's a dot product. I pick the direction that is?
Oh, parallel.
Parallel.
Yeah.
So if I go in the direction of the gradient, I will maximize my slope. So the gradient tells me which way to go to make the change in my height biggest. That seems to be huge because I just said that really slowly. And normally I talk very quickly. So when I'm slowing down, that means it's an important note to take, right? So if that yellow vector is the gradient. So right now, doesn't this look basically like it's flat? I try to get the axes to kind of line up for us. And why does that make sense? Because it looks like the direction I want to go in, it looks like it's probably how related to the gradient?
Perpendicular.
Yes, orthogonal. Yeah. I like it. Perpendicular, I'll accept that word too. And if these two are orthogonal, then my derivative is
zero
because the dot product is zero when the two things are perpendicular or orthogonal. So what's really interesting, if you think about that, everywhere on a level curve, you are at a point that is orthogonal to the gradient at that point. Let me say that again. If you're on a level curve and you follow the level curve, everywhere that's on a level curve, and you're moving along the level curve, that means you're at a point, you're somewhere that is orthogonal to the gradient at that point. So if I go in the direction of the gradient, I'm going to have the steepest climb. If I go orthogonal to the gradient, I'm going to be flat. If I go the complete opposite direction, I'm going to have the steepest
decline,
the steepest decrease in height. I love it. So let's see if we can kind of, this is almost a good visualization. So if I want this red line to have the highest slope, the largest slope in the direction I'm going, I want to line up the blue line and the yellow, the blue and the yellow, so if I can line those up, that looks like it's pretty steep. Whereas if I'm making them orthogonal, that looks like it's pretty flat. Right? If I make it perfectly against it, then that, of course, is the steepest decrease, because that's the direction I'm moving in. That blue is the direction I'm moving in. I like it. So you have two different levels to these problems. You have, if you're standing on a mountain and you're talking about the direction you're going to go in, you're talking about x, y. Now, the change in height is the output of that direction you're moving in. So we talk about surfaces and derivatives in those two separate ways at the same time. So if I show you a level curve, a collection of level curves, that's just thinking about 2D with the 3D indicated by the numbers. Right, the third dimension, the height indicated by the numbers. Here I am trying to show both at once. I'm talking about my what way am I looking versus the change in height from where I'm standing. So if I look opposite from the gradient vector, I'm going to go down the fastest. Right.
Okay. Let's see. What else was there? I think that's enough for this guy. Oh, here's one last thing. Before I let you do this little handout. But wait, there's more. If you buy two ShamWows, I'll give you a third ShamWow for free.
What?
All right. Given z equals f of x, y, what procedure do I use? And some of you guys just use the procedure on the x credit to find the tangent plane at some point. Yeah, so the procedure is take the partial of f of x, partial of f with respect to x, and x naught, y naught. That'll be times x minus x naught. And that equals z minus z naught. Now, are there functions that we have seen? Are there surfaces that we have seen that I actually cannot write like this? You guys see something like this and you don't even stop to think. We've seen surfaces that can't be written like this. Yet they should have their own freaking tangent planes. Seems a little unfair. So if you look back, if you have your book, look back in section 12.6, where they have all the collections of different surfaces. Look, for example, at an ellipsoid, right? Poor little ellipsoid, dude. Looks like this. Can you put that in that form? No. If you think you can, you're wrong. You have to put a plus or minus, which means there's two functions, a positive one and a negative one. So you can't follow this procedure for that. You guys, in fact, you, dear God, do you understand you would not want to try to solve for z and bring a square root to try to do these? No. So there's a more general procedure then. This is actually a specific instance where you can solve for z. Just to try to cut to the chase here a little bit, the more general procedure. In fact, let me see. Well, let me do it this way. More generally, for f of x, y, z equal to some constant. That's just like the ellipsoid. The ellipsoid was x squared, a squared, y squared, b squared, c. Z squared, c squared equals 1. So it's a function of x, y, z equal to a constant. Cool. For that type of form, the way that this is going to look is this guy is going to pick up his own derivative. So if you think about it right now, what's the partial with respect to z, sort of is like 1, right? In a way. We'll see here in a little bit that it's not exactly 1. So what you're going to get is this. You're going to get fx at x naught, y naught, x minus x naught plus fy, x naught, y naught, times y minus y naught, plus fz, x naught, y naught. Well, I should be putting z naught everywhere, but oh well. Z minus z naught equals 0. Because when you take the derivative of k, you're going to get 0. That's where that 0 comes from. And now watch. If I have an equation like this, how do I make it look like this? I just subtract z. So I'm going to try to show you how this is the same thing as this. So does it make sense on one level that this is just an extension of this old idea of how to get a tangent plane? It's just an extension of it. Here, there was nothing here because it was just a function of x and y. Now it's a function of x, y, and z. So we've got to introduce this slope for the z's. So now watch, this is kind of neat. If I had something, so if I have this, And this is a more general approach. This should lead to this. That's how you always check. Whenever you try to generalize something, you go back and you make sure, does it still work for this case? If it doesn't, you made a mistake somewhere, right? So if I do have this, and I just subtract z from both sides, isn't it now in this form, where f of x, y, z is f of x, y minus z? So then I could use that. Now what would f, here we go, you ready? No, okay. This is big ass f. What is f partial z? You can do it. What's f partial z? What is this whole thing? This is a function of x and y. So when I do partial respect to z, this whole thing is?
Zero.
A constant. So the derivative is zero. I love it. And what's the derivative of negative z?
Negative one.
So I put a negative one here in front of this, right? Put a negative one here in front of this, which means I got to add it to the other side, and you get freaking this again. So these are the same stupid thing. So this is something you wouldn't even realize, of course, as a student. You feel all great. I can find a tangent plane to anything. No, you can't, because not everything can be written like this. So now for everything in 12.6 and anything else that you can't solve for z. And there's a course, I could do something like this. Here's a surface. There's a surface. Yeah. All right, let me get one. Now, on one level, you guys should be able to just sit there and say, yeah, that's a surface, sure. Yeah. You can plug shit in and get shit out, right?
Yes.
For any x and y I pick, I can get a z, or for any z and y, I can try to get an x. I can do that. Now, not everything's going to work. There's certain restrictions on the domain. You guys with me? Now, we're not going to analyze this. I'm not going to make this number one on the test. All my whole point is, it's if you didn't really agree with me that you couldn't solve an ellipsoid for z, you sure as all hell should be able to agree with me you can't solve this for z. I don't care who you are. You cannot solve this for z. It's too intertwined in everything. So then that's it should still have a tangent plane at the surface at every point. It should still have one, poor little dude. So there we go. We developed a more general approach for something I can't solve for z. So this approach works. It's a more specific version of this. This approach works if I can solve it for z. But this is the more general approach. If I can't solve it for z, I can use this. So let me give you this. On one side is what I want you to work on right now. It's got the green parabolas, right? Very strange collection of superheroes, the green parabolas. And then the other side's your practice test. Oh, yes, really a lot.